Ms. Eckersley, if you would just remain standing, face the jury and members of the jury, I'm going to ask you stand up while I swear you in, please.
Can I ask just the clerk to please keep your voice on? Thank you.
Members of the jury, if you would raise your right hand, please. And at the conclusion of the oath, please say, "I will." You so solemnly swear or affirm that you will carefully consider the evidence and the law presented to you in this case, and that you will deliver a fair and true verdict as to the charge or charges against the defendant, so help you God.
I will.
Thank you. Members of the jury, you can be seated. Ms. Eckersley, I'm going to ask that you please remain standing. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I'm going to read you the charges in this matter. There are five charges in this case, and these are in Superior Court Docket 216-2022-CR-3011. The first is charge ID 205-4609C, and this states that Alexandra Eckersley, on or about the 26th day of December 2022, at Manchester, in the county of Hillsborough aforesaid, did commit the crime of second-degree assault, in that Eckersley recklessly caused bodily injury to another under circumstances manifesting extreme indifference to the value of human life, when Eckersley caused respiratory distress to her newborn infant when she abandoned the newborn infant where the ambient temperature was extremely cold. This is contrary to the form of the statute in such case made and provided and against the peace and dignity of the state. The next charge is charge ID 205-4610C, and this states that Alexandra Eckersley, on or about the 26th day of December 2022, at Manchester in the county of Hillsborough aforesaid, did commit the crime of second-degree assault, in that Eckersley recklessly caused bodily injury to another under circumstances manifesting extreme indifference to the value of human life, when Eckersley caused hypothermia to her newborn infant when she abandoned the newborn infant where the ambient temperature was extremely cold, contrary to the form of the statute in such case made and provided and against the peace and dignity of the state. The next charge is charge ID 204-5612C, and this states that Alexandra Eckersley, on or about the 26th day of December 2022, at Manchester, in the county of Hillsborough aforesaid, did commit the crime of reckless conduct, in that Eckersley recklessly engaged in conduct that placed another in danger of serious bodily injury when Eckersley abandoned her newborn infant where the ambient temperature was extremely cold, contrary to the form of the statute in such case made and provided and against the peace and dignity of the state. The next is charge ID 204-5614C. This charge states that Alexandra Eckersley, on or about the 26th day of December 2022, at Manchester, in the county of Hillsborough aforesaid, did commit the crime of falsifying physical evidence, in that Eckersley, believing that an investigation was about to be instituted, concealed the location of her newborn infant with the purpose to impair its availability in such investigation, contrary to the form of the statute in such case made and provided and against the peace and dignity of the state. And the last charge is charge ID 204-5633C, and this charge states that Alexandra Eckersley, at Manchester, on or about the 27th day of December 2022, did commit the offense of endangering the welfare of a child or incompetent, in that Alexandra Eckersley knowingly endangered the welfare of her prematurely newborn infant, date of birth 12/26/2022, by purposely violating a duty of care or protection, which endangered the infant's health or safety, when Eckersley abandoned the newborn infant in a tent without heat or proper clothing in the woods when the outside temperature was approximately 15 degrees Fahrenheit and failed to immediately seek medical assistance for over an hour. This is against the peace and dignity of the state. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the defendant, Alexandra Eckersley, has been arraigned on these charges and she has pleaded not guilty. And of this, she puts herself upon her country for trial, which country you are. Assistant County Attorneys Sean Sweeney and Alexander Gatsoulis for the state have joined the issue, and you are to say by your verdict if the defendant, Alexandra Eckersley, is guilty of the crime she stands indicted or not guilty. Hearken to the evidence. Thank you. Ms. Eckersley, you can be seated.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Members of the jury, you are about to hear opening statements by counsel. Before that, I'm going to give you some general instructions as to the law that applies to this case and some other matters which will give you some guidance as you consider the evidence in the case. After you have heard the evidence and you have heard closing arguments, you will hear further instructions from the court, and then you will retire to the jury deliberation room to decide your verdict. You should consider all of the instructions that I give to you, both now and at the end of the case as a whole, and not single out one particular instruction as stating the law. You will also have a written copy of my instructions with you in the jury deliberation room. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is not a memory test. You are going to have as many copies of these instructions as you want in the jury deliberation room. I usually send back 6 copies initially, but your first order of business may be to ask for 12, and that's fine as well. So please, this morning, just listen carefully, okay? The function of the court and the jury. In order to reach a fair and just verdict, you must understand and follow the law as I explain it to you. For example, you have to understand the definition of the crimes with which the defendant is charged. You have to understand how convinced one way or the other you should be before you reach a verdict. You have to understand what to consider in deciding whether to believe a particular witness. These instructions will explain the law as to these and other matters so that you can reach a fair and just verdict. It is your duty as jurors to follow all of the instructions that I give to you, regardless of any opinion you may have as to what the law ought to be. The law as I explain it to you is the law you must follow in reaching your verdict. It is up to you to decide the facts. You must decide the facts solely from the evidence in this trial. You must apply the law given to you in these instructions to the facts, and in this way reach a fair and just verdict. You should decide the facts without prejudice, without fear, and without sympathy. You should decide this case based solely on the evidence presented and the law as I explain it to you. The evidence in the case. In deciding this case, you should consider only the evidence in the case. The evidence consists of testimony under oath of the witnesses, exhibits which have been admitted into evidence, facts of which I take judicial notice, stipulations of certain facts, and what you see on the view. During the trial, the lawyers may make objections. The lawyers are supposed to object when they believe that certain evidence is not admissible. If I sustain an objection or exclude any evidence, you must not guess as to what the answer or evidence would have been. If I order that a question and answer be stricken from the record, you must not consider either the question or the answer as evidence. A judge is required to be neutral, and I am, in fact, neutral. If during this trial or at any time during this process you believe that I have expressed or suggested an opinion as to the facts in my rulings, you should ignore that belief. It is up to you alone to decide the facts. In short, you should consider only the legally admissible evidence in deciding this case, that is, the testimony of the witnesses, the exhibits, stipulations, facts of which I take judicial notice, and the view. The indictments are not evidence. The fact that the defendant has been arrested and indicted is not evidence of guilt. The indictments are simply a way of giving the defendant notice of the charges. The indictments are a formal way of accusing the defendant of a crime in order to bring the defendant to trial. You must not consider the indictments as evidence of guilt. The possible punishment the defendant may receive if you return a verdict of guilty should not influence your decision. The duty of imposing sentence is solely for the judge. You should base your verdict only on the evidence and the law without considering the possible punishment. The presumption of innocence. As you were instructed during the general selection process, there is a presumption of innocence that applies and continues throughout this trial until the state convinces you beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant is guilty of each and every element of the offenses with which she has been charged. And the defendant has no obligation whatsoever to prove her innocence in this matter. And that includes the right not to testify if she so chooses. You are not allowed to draw any unfavorable, adverse, or negative inference if the defendant does not take the stand in this matter. The jury's recollection controls. You will hear the lawyers discuss the facts and the law in their opening statements and closing arguments to you. These statements and arguments are not evidence. Their purpose is to help you understand the evidence and the law. If the lawyers have stated the law differently from the law as I explain it to you in these instructions, then you must follow these instructions and ignore the statements of the lawyers. If the lawyers have stated the evidence differently from how you recall it, then you should follow your own memory of what the evidence was. Direct and circumstantial evidence. There are two kinds of evidence, direct and circumstantial. Direct evidence is direct proof of a fact, such as the testimony or statement of a person about what the person saw, heard, or did. Circumstantial evidence is indirect evidence, that is, proof of a chain of facts from which you could find that another fact exists, although it has not been proved directly. For example, if you look outside and see water droplets falling from the sky, that is direct evidence that it is raining. But if you look out the window at night and the ground is dry, and you look again the next morning and the ground is wet, that is indirect or circumstantial evidence that it rained during the night. By circumstantial evidence, I simply mean that you may infer the ultimate fact from another fact shown. You should feel free to reach reasonable conclusions from proven facts. Conversely, you may not reach conclusions based on facts that have not been proved. In the rain example, wet ground alone may support an inference that it rained during the night. But in the absence of additional evidence, it will not necessarily support inferences about how much rain fell or for how long a period of time. You should consider both kinds of evidence. You are permitted to give equal weight to both, but it is for you to decide how much weight to give any evidence, whether it is direct or circumstantial. However, to be sufficient to establish guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, circumstantial evidence must exclude all other rational conclusions. This means that if, from the circumstantial evidence, it is rational to arrive at two conclusions, one consistent with guilt and one consistent with innocence, then you must choose the rational conclusion consistent with innocence. In determining whether all rational conclusions other than guilt have been excluded, you should not consider any item of circumstantial evidence in isolation. Rather, you should consider each item of circumstantial evidence in the context of all of the other evidence, which includes all other circumstantial and direct evidence. You must understand, however, that this circumstantial evidence rule does not apply to direct evidence. If there's a conflict between two or more witnesses who offer direct evidence concerning certain facts, you should resolve the conflict. For example, suppose there are two witnesses to a crime, and one testifies that the defendant committed the crime, and another testifies that the defendant did not commit the crime. This presents a situation where there is a conflict in direct evidence. In this situation, you, the jury, should resolve the conflict and must decide, based upon all of the evidence, whether the state has proved the defendant's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. You should consider all of the direct and circumstantial evidence in the case, as well as any reasonable inferences you draw therefrom in deciding whether the state has proved all of the elements of the crime beyond a reasonable doubt. The credibility of witnesses. In deciding this case, you must decide the credibility of the witnesses. That is, it is up to you to decide who to believe. If there is any conflict between the witnesses, then you must resolve the conflict. Simply because a witness has taken an oath to tell the truth does not mean that you have to accept the testimony as true. Use your common sense and judgment. Consider factors you use in your everyday lives in deciding important issues. For example, you may consider the following: the witness's attitude, behavior, and appearance on the stand, and the way the witness testifies. The witness's age, intelligence, and experience. The witness's opportunity and ability to see or hear the things about which the witness testifies.
the accuracy of the witness's memory, any motive of the witness not to tell the truth, any interest that the witness has in the outcome of the case, any bias of the witness or friendship or animosity the witness may have for or against any of the other people in the case, the consistency or inconsistency of the witness's testimony, whether or not what the witness says appears reasonable or unreasonable, whether what the witness says is consistent or inconsistent with the testimony of other witnesses or with statements the witness made at another time. In deciding which witnesses to believe and how much of their testimony to believe, you should consider both the direct and cross-examination of the witness. If you believe that part of a witness's testimony is false, you may choose to distrust other parts also, but you are not required to do so. Inconsistencies and contradictions within a witness's testimony or between witnesses do not necessarily mean that you should disbelieve the witness. It is possible for honest people to witness the same event and see or hear things differently. You should evaluate inconsistencies and contradictions and determine whether they are important or unimportant. You need not believe any witness even though the testimony is uncontradicted, nor are you required to accept testimony as true simply because some or even all of the witnesses agree with each other. You may find the testimony of one or a few witnesses more persuasive than the testimony of a larger number. These principles apply to all witnesses, whether they are ordinary citizens, police officers, experts, or otherwise. In short, you should consider the testimony of each witness and give it the weight you think it deserves. The weight to be given to the evidence should be determined by the quality of the evidence, not the quantity. It is not the number of witnesses or quantity of evidence, but the quality of the evidence that is important. The judge decides what is admissible. Testimony, writings, objects, and other things presented during the trial are evidence only if the judge accepts them as evidence. Throughout the trial, I may rule on whether certain evidence is admissible or inadmissible. These are legal decisions which do not concern you, because only the judge is permitted to decide legal questions. I may make three types of legal decisions with regard to the evidence. First, I may stop some information from being presented at all. You are not to imagine what that information might have been had I allowed it to be presented. Second, I may rule that some information was not admissible after it was presented to you. You are to ignore this information and not use it as evidence. Finally, I may allow some information to be entered as evidence after hearing objections by one of the lawyers. You are not to give such evidence any special importance as a result of my ruling. It is not my duty, and I do not try to determine whether evidence is important when I make my rulings. The burden of proof and reasonable doubt. I've addressed what you should not consider and what you should consider in reaching a verdict. I'm now going to discuss how convinced one way or the other you must be, and this is referred to as the burden of proof. Under our constitutions, all defendants in criminal cases are presumed to be innocent until proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. The burden of proving guilt is entirely on the state. The defendant does not have to prove her innocence. As I told you earlier, the defendant enters this courtroom as an innocent person, and you must consider her to be an innocent person until the state convinces you beyond a reasonable doubt that she is guilty of each and every element of the alleged offense. If after all the evidence and arguments you have a reasonable doubt as to the defendant having committed any one or more elements of the offense, then you must find her not guilty. Now, finally, ladies and gentlemen, a reasonable doubt is just what the words would ordinarily imply. The use of the word reasonable means simply that the doubt must be reasonable rather than unreasonable. It must be a doubt based upon reason. It is not a frivolous or fanciful doubt, nor is it one that can easily be explained away. Rather, it is such a doubt based on reason as remains after consideration of all of the evidence that the state has offered against it. The test you must use is this. If you have a reasonable doubt as to whether the state has proven any one or more of the elements of the crime charged, you must find the defendant not guilty. However, if you find that the state has proven all of the elements of the offense charged beyond a reasonable doubt, then you should find the defendant guilty. Ladies and gentlemen, as I mentioned to you during the jury selection process, we are going to begin this case with a view. We will be traveling to several locations within the city of Manchester to observe certain areas that you will be hearing testimony about. The purpose of the view is to make the testimony you will hear more understandable. If you have the opportunity to look at the scene, the testimony may make more sense to you. Your obligation on the view is to look as carefully as you can and to remember what you see as well as you can. You may not ask questions. You may not take any notes or measurements. You should look carefully at what the lawyers will be pointing out to you. What you see, what you see on the view is evidence in the case. Please stay as close together as possible so that you all will be viewing the scene from approximately the same perspective. If you cannot hear or see, please call that to my attention or to the attention of a court officer. After the view is completed, you may not revisit the scenes on your own during trial. Also, you may not engage in any discussion among yourselves or with anyone else concerning what you see at the view until jury deliberations. As you know, you are not to talk with each other or with anyone else about the case until the very end of the trial when you are conducting your deliberations. With respect to the final instructions regarding the offenses, ladies and gentlemen, I will wait until the end of trial and after closing arguments and discuss it with you at that time. I'm going to give you one last instruction. This instruction I gave to you a little bit earlier during the jury selection process. It's called the communication instruction. Please listen carefully. I'll give you some form of this instruction as we go throughout the trial, so just listen carefully. Please do not discuss the case at all, not with other members of the jury or with anyone else, until jury deliberations start at the end of the trial after all of the evidence and the final arguments have been presented. Please keep an open mind until you have heard all of the evidence in the case. During the course of the trial, please take care to avoid any contact with any persons involved in the case, the lawyers, the witnesses, or the parties. With regard to that, ladies and gentlemen, you may see some individuals involved in this case as you come in and out of the courthouse, for example. They also have been instructed that they are not to have any communication with you. So if they don't smile at you or look at you or acknowledge your presence, please know they're not being rude. They are just following the court's instruction. Please be sure to avoid any television, radio, online, or newspaper coverage of this case, should there be any. Finally, do not conduct any research or investigation of your own concerning the case. You must render your verdict based solely on the evidence submitted during trial. Ladies and gentlemen, in this case, there may be some media coverage. It is your highest obligation as jurors to avoid any newspaper, television, online coverage of this case. Do not read it. Do not look at it. Your verdict in this case must be based exclusively on the evidence that is presented at trial. Our trial day will generally go from approximately 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. We will also generally take a mid-morning and mid-afternoon break. The court has asked you to put your cell phones in a box in the jury deliberation room. I know we have one exception to that for a certain purpose, but otherwise your phones should be in the box in the jury deliberation room. Please make sure they are silenced or turned off. You will be permitted to check your phones on a break. However, you are not permitted to take notes of any kind, not on paper nor on your phones. The reason for this is that it is important that your recollection of the evidence is what controls. If notes are taken, sometimes they can be given undue weight, and it's important that when it comes time to deliberate, you are using your individual and collective memories about the evidence, and one note or one written recollection does not control. You should also be aware that there is no transcript that will be available to you when it comes time to deliberate. Therefore, please listen carefully to the evidence as it is presented. If during trial you have any questions or problems, please get the bailiff's attention. If you become thirsty or need anything else, again, please direct your questions to the court officer and he or she will assist you. If at any time during the trial you cannot hear, please raise your hand so that I may ask the lawyers or the witness to speak up.